Yo, 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 yo. It's your boy Vigilante Styles, man. And, that's what was moving around. Damn it. So, we're making a beat. And we're going to mix the beat, of course, while we're making it. So, I'm doing the whole thing. So, I'm working with a sample. Yeah, I work in the box, but I don't want the in-the-box sound, if you know what I mean. Like, I do not want a digital sounding mix in the end. Because I think digital mixes sound fucking whack. That's my opinion, you know. It is what it is. I don't like the way that they sound. I don't give a... But I've come to find the plugins that I do like. Yes, I got this massive plugin list, and I hate it, to be honest. But I had to go through this, spend a lot of money to find out what I really liked. So, I like the Neve, man. I like that modern Neve sound. I would get the 88 RS channel if they would make that native from UAD. And then I would probably just use that. Or if Brainworks made their own. Although they may have already made their own with this one. This one is pretty close to an 88R. Because the Neve VXS they modeled was from Skywalker Sound. And it had some Neve 88R stuff going on under the hood. They like changed out the pre's and the EQ. The compressor on the VX and the 88R are the same compressor. So it's a similar, so you're getting a similar vibe from this. So this is good enough for me. And I like the sound of the VX and that mod, the 88R basically, and the VXS. So, but I like the classic Neve sound. I do. I like that too. Don't get me wrong. All right, so let's work this sample. Well, there's a couple other things I want to do with this. I want to make this sample sound like it went through some hardware, not just the Neve console, but like a hardware sampler. So in order to do that, we need to throw Fruity Balance on here and get this fun plugin called Disimort. And I'm going to put it ahead of the console in, and we're going to switch it to an ASR10. I love the sound of the ASR10. See, a long time ago, guys, I met South Park Mexican before all the trouble. And he was working on Hustletown. Him and Filero, I met them both. They're working on Hustletown, and SPM had a ASR10, and that was the very first time I ever heard the ASR10 in person. And it sounded wonderful. Just sounded absolutely amazing. And I chased that sound because I just love the way it sounds. Just a beautiful sounding piece of hardware. So why I put a balancer ahead of Decimort is, you know, trying not to send a hot signal into the plugin. So that is, I guess you would call that gain staging. So let's find a section of this that we like. This kind of starts in a weird way. I don't know if it should go dun or if it should go dun dun dun, you know. Oh, I probably should because that's where the kick drum starts. Okay. Yeah, the kick drum starts there, so that's pretty close. And then you know what I want to start here? Because I don't want that crash cymbal in there. I'm going to add my own crash cymbal, so I don't want that one. Because I mean, I know that guitar is going to be in there, but I don't want it in there too long. Let's see if this is acceptable. I kind of think that guitar is going to get annoying over time. Let's try another section. Let's try it from this section here, where it seems like the guitar ends. And let's see. If I sample a longer section, maybe it won't be so bad. I need to kill it right there. I think I might want to screw this down a bit. But before I do, I mean, it could work. My only issue is that crash, but let's try it, because maybe when I screw it down, and you know, maybe that'd be better. Oh, let me get the tempo. What the hell? So 89 is pretty close. All right, so let's drop that in. I think I'm only going to grab that section. I'm going to try to build around that. So we'll see. I don't know how this is going to turn out. So you want to just make sure it fits within the timing. That's going to affect the pitch slightly. So we don't really care too much about that because we're going to slow it down. But otherwise, you would go here, go to mode, and set it to auto, and then it'll keep the pitch. But when you leave it at resample, you can play with the pitch when you play with the speed, which is what I'm doing. So from here, if we want to know what key this is in, I would go just slap tuner on it. So it looks like B and D sharp. So that gives me a little bit of an idea of what key this is in. But let's go and throw some drums over the top of this. I want this to have a, I don't know. I guess I kind of want it to have that DJ screw kind of vibe to it. Kind of thinking these drums, because once I extend them out to 2 bars, they're going to be pitched down automatically, and then they should have kind of that DJ screw vibe a little bit, which is what I'm going for on this. So slap it on here and let's route it through our console, right? Our virtual Neve VXS, and random the channel. Let's hear how that sounds. Originally wasn't sure about that drum track, but I think I can work with it. Yeah, I kind of like it. Sounds good. Kind of like that big kicks 03 here. I kind of want to do 3 kicks. This is a crazy idea, but there's a method to the madness for this one. They're not going to be layered, but they're going to alternate. So that's gonna add a little bit more vibe to that. So let's put this in here. We'll go and work the drum tracks, and then we'll route them into our virtual Neve. There's little blips in there. may have to play with the swing function a little bit. I mix as I go when I'm making beats, a lot of the time. Because when you hear the beat mixed as you go, you might pick certain sounds that kind of go a little better with what you're, you know, what you've already done. I don't know. It's a weird thing I believe in. Like, you might pick sounds that have a similar color to what you've just done, you know? That's kind of my philosophy. Which then kind of makes mixing easier in a way, too. A little too hard. A little bit less. Yeah. A little bit top. Good. All right, and then a little top on this. Sure as to how this is gonna sound. I mean, I'm not sure what sound I want to pick from this, but I have an idea. Let me go up here and put this on. Excuse me. I'm gonna go with like a ratio of like 3. Yeah, okay, so B, we're gonna have to try to find out what keys these everything's in. I know we have B and D sharp, I believe, was two keys. So let's try to figure out, because I don't know if it's a minor or major. I mean, I'm gonna go with B minor for now, but was D sharp in that? It's not. Yeah, let's go with major. B. D sharp is in it. Okay. We don't know if this is gonna work. I think we are in the right key. It's all about now just trying to find a good melody. I'm just gonna play around with something until it sounds right. Strange as that sounds, that might work. I'm gonna get rid of that one though. Chimes. It's kind of a West, like a classic West Coast sound, I guess. I don't know. I guess I've been on that kind of vibe for a minute. But. I'm thinking of adding strings over the top of this just to give it a little bit more fullness. So at least I can, there's more that I can take away. There's more that I can take away from the chorus. So when it breaks down to the sample and the drums, that at the very minimum, it'll sound like it's actually breaking down pretty well, as opposed to just having just this lead synth and then that disappears and then. It's kind of what I'm thinking. Just give it a little bit more fullness. Could. Let's try it. Yeah, I was thinking there's really nothing I could really do. Just kind of keep it the same, I guess, through this whole thing. Go into the chorus. crazy buildups, crazy fills, none of that. Very simple transitions. And it's more repetitive because this is supposed to have a lyricist over these first sections. So a guy that's going to be rapping to this. No, a person who would be rapping to this is going to be rapping, like, you know, slow, you know? You know, like a screw flow, you know what I'm saying? Like a, man, hold up, boss to get crunk. I'ma come through, I'ma pop trunk. I'ma get down, man, I'm gon' clown. I'ma smoke green, do it by the pound. Roll with my G's, blazing up trees. Wanna see me on the motherfucking scene. You know, like, that's what you would do. And then, like, on the vocal parts, like, over the rhyming words, I'd probably put, like, a delay. So, like, they would have a backing vocal track, and then I would throw a delay on that. Like, on the backing track, they're just gonna accent the main words, you know, the main rhyming words. So they're gonna, like, man, hold up, when they'd say up, crunk, punk, chunk, and then I would put a delay on that, maybe a ping pong delay too, and maybe put a stereo spreader on that backing vocal, and that would sound really dope, I think, for this kind of sound, you know. This is like a screw, classic screw, 90s screw, you know what I'm saying, type of shit. Because I know it has a West Coast vibe to it too, but, you know, I grew up in Houston. I live in Atlanta now, but I grew up in Houston, and this was the kind of stuff that we heard, like, on the screw tapes and stuff. That's kind of, like, what I was going for on this, you know. And that's how they would kick a flow to that, you know. Man, I come down. Man, I bounce the clown. I'ma smoke green, do it by the pound. Represent my city, showing no pity. See a bad bitch, she got the big titties. Man, I'm gon' holla, bitch, I get a dollar. I'ma come through, I'm a ghetto scholar. You know, riding in the fucking Impala. Hey, talking shit, nada. No, how I'm gon' go, how I'm gon' flow, how I'm gon' smoke. Pimpin' these bitches, put them in ditches. Haters on my shit list, fuck them with the quickness. Tell your girl to lick this, then she passed the litmus. See me over here, now this bitch is dismissed. I don't know, you know, just, I don't know, I was kicking some stupid shit off the dome, but I'm just saying, you know, like, that's what I think somebody would be doing to this. That's what I envision. I don't know if you would want to rap fast to this, though, you know, like, man, I be throwed, smoking that dro, pippin' them hoes, kicking that flow, giving that fuck with this hoe, you know, I don't know, whatever, I don't know, you probably could, I guess. I don't know, you could probably kick a fast forward. Better be throat now, when I'm in that mode now. When I'm smoking that drone now. When I'm pippin' them hoes, I don't give a fuck with these haters, they really don't know now. That shit that I do now, I'm getting that high, I'm jamming my screw now. Who gives a fuck about your crew now? Giving a fuck what it do now. Many know, out, I'm gone. I'm in that zone, smoking that shit. Gonna be blazing up, homegrown. Now you know. How we gon' go? Burning the drone, pippin' them hoes, kicking them doughs, giving a fuck with these fucking ass hoes. Giving a fuck about my foes. Smoking weed, I'm blazing dough. Blazing drone. I don't know, you could probably kick a flow like that, I guess. That'd be alright. That could work. I'm just thinking of the pattern. Like, none of that shit I said made any fucking sense, really, you know? And on the hook, I don't think, like, anybody would really sing on the hook. You could probably, like, have, like, a sample. Like, I'd probably have the lyricist like, rap something, like a hook, and then we'll just pitch it down so it sounds like a screw thing, you know what I'm saying, over the hook. So it sounds like they're like, man, I get though, man, I'm in the boat, man, I get though. Man, I'm in the mode. Smoke that what drove.
Pimp that one hoe, smoke that one drone. Pimp that one hoe,
I don't know, just something like that. That's the kind of shit that I'm vibing, I'm thinking about to this kind of beat, you know? Then at the end, like this part, they probably might say, just, you know, talk something like, this is how we do in these streets, keeping it real on a daily, you know, just blazing one, fuck it, got no time for the stress, got that cess in my chest. You know, and I was thinking maybe like a fade out or something, you know, that could work. That's the kind of shit I think about, man, when I'm working on beats, man. So I don't know, that's an idea, you know. When you're making a beat, you should have an idea of like how an artist is gonna approach the song, you know. That's why I think really good producers are also really good artists. Now I'm too old to be rapping, dude. I mean like not too old to be rapping. Like I could rap, but I'm too old really for trying to make a career out of it. You know what I'm saying? I don't know anybody who starts in their 40s, man, and like just becomes the biggest thing ever. I just can't see it. I mean, yeah, maybe I could be the first, I don't know, but I doubt it, you know. So usually I want a younger person who's kind of seeing things musically the way that I'm seeing things to be on a track like this. I mean, like obviously I know that like you're not going to get anybody who's like 18 on a track like this. You know what I'm saying? No 20-year-old dudes rapping on this. Not going to be that. But you could probably get somebody in their 30s, you know, to probably rap on something like this. Mid to late 30s or so. Or maybe early 30s kind of dude. And I'm thinking, dude, man, a woman could hit this too, man. She can get on this track, man, and just fire it up, you know? So, I mean... But that's kind of like... That's kind of vibe I've been in, you know? And like I said, is that my best beat I've ever made? Nah, by far not. But I mean, for the video, you know, give you an idea of what I'm doing. And not just mixing and mastering other people's stuff. You know, I'm actually working on my own music too. And you see what I use to get my sound. And I think it sounds good. You know, so quality-wise, it sounds fire to me, you know. Like, that was a solid mix to me, man. That's going to sound good everywhere you play that, man. But that's what I like to do, man. That's how I get down. So hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, like, subscribe, hit the notification bell. I don't always show beats because, you know, I don't think you guys are really into my beats. Obviously, this is a perfect example of that. Like, yeah, it's okay. It's an all right beat, but it's for, you know, a certain kind of person. You know what I'm saying? It's an acquired taste. They're like, what are you doing in Atlanta? You're not making trap music. You know, it's like, I'm bored with it, dude. That's what it is. It's not that I can't make trap music or I don't want to make drill. Actually, I don't want to make drill. Let's be honest. I don't want to make drill music. I don't like that stuff. But like trap, I don't mind making trap beats from time to time. But I'm just bored with trap beats, dude. I want to do some other shit. Like that. I'm thinking like other producers got to be the same way. Like, dude, I ain't bored with this shit. I don't give a fuck if that's what people want to hear. I don't even know if that's what people want to hear, man. That's just what's being pushed out to people, man. Because, I mean, I don't think really people, I think they're bored with it too, you know? Like, we need a new fucking sound, guys. And what I mean by a new sound is go dig in the past and go dig up an old sound and make it new, you know? That's kind of what I've been doing. For me, I just found that old screw vibe, man, that old 90s screw vibe. I know it's part of my nature of growing up in H-Town, you know, when I was younger, when I was in high school and shit, back in the 90s. But it still is... It's kind of a sound that even Houston's kind of really not doing that sound anymore, you know? Like, it's a lost art, you know? And so I figured, man, I mean, they do this... Because, I mean, let's be honest, man. In, like, 2005 or whatever, they were doing, like... You know, they had Swisher House. But, man, that's... Look, man, if you grew up in Houston, you know that Swisher House is not... really the sound. Like, they kind of, I'm gonna be honest, dude, and people gonna be pissed off at me for this one, but I don't give a fuck. I know the history, right? I lived in H-Town during these times. So they jacked that sound from screw, man. That was the whole sound. Everything Swisher House was about was jacking everything the screw was doing, like screw and all the people that roll with screw. But they did do one thing that's different, though. They took a little bit of that sound from kind of like what UGK was doing too, though, right? Pimp C sound and stuff like that. So they kind of blended that, because Pimp C sound was a little different. The guys in, like, that were doing, like, you guys, I'm going to put you up on game, right? You guys need to peep. If you want to know the shit that I'm talking about, go get the DJ Screw albums, right? All Work, No Play. If you're lucky enough to find, like, the actual gray tapes and shit that he sold, that maybe might be uploaded on YouTube or somewhere. Listen to those. Listen to old school SPM, man. And I'm talking his first album, like Hillwood, right? Listen to Hillwood. Listen to Street Military, Bam. Bam, B-A-M, Bam. Listen to Bam. Listen to Half Dead Organization, right? Listen to those guys. Listen to, because you got to think, all these guys were around Screw at the time, man. All these dudes, South Park Coalition, K Reno, 38, Point Blank, all them dudes, you know, Get High with the Blanks to that song, you know, all that stuff like that. Those, you could, DJ DMD, he's from Port Arthur, but his sound was more along the lines of what they were doing with, you know, Screw, you know what I'm saying? DJ Screw and their crew. Lil Kiki, by the way, Lil Kiki, there was another crew called Mob Figures. I think you could check them out too. They weren't too big, but they were on the same label with him. Al D, listen to Al D. But that's just, so you can get an idea where this sound is that I just did is coming from. You know what I'm saying? It's coming from that vibe. And Swisher House jacked that. I'm gonna be honest, dude. They took the whole thing. Like, the DJ Michael 5000 Watts, right? He was from 97.9 The Box, and he was just a regular ass DJ. Like, doing, like, all, like, New York DJ type of shit, you know, on 97.9 The Box. And then he started slowing down records and screwing and chopping stuff just like Screw. And I'm like, dude, copycat, man. What the fuck, you know? And back in the day, people were pissed off at that when you copy him. Like, that's Screw shit. You are a biter, right? Stealing his shit. But then he died, you see. But they were already starting to do that shit before he died. Like, Swisher House was a thing. I think they started coming up in the 90s, and they were doing a lot of the same thing. Well, anyway, then when Screw died and then Fat Pat and, you know, Hawk and all these other dudes, you know what I'm saying? When they pass away, then it was kind of like, well, all you got left is Swisher House, really, doing that kind of stuff. So that's why they take the sound to the national scene, you know? So I'll give them that, you know, they did take that sound and make it national, and they commercialized it, right? They took that sound and they commercialized it. But like I said, it's a bit different than what they were doing, you know, this kind of production here. This is definitely to the roots. You know what I'm saying? This is to the roots. Screw ESG, by the way. How can I forget him? He was like that's the first dude I ever heard screwed down before. I thought my tape deck was all messed up. And I was like, no, wait, the tape is supposed to be like this. And, you know, it's slowed down and there's all this chopping and stuff, and I was like, that's interesting. But then, you know, like, I just really just sat there and I go, you know what, the music kind of does sound kind of cool like this when it's slowed down, and kind of gives it a deeper vibe, you know, just a whole nother vibe. And in a way, it's kind of like lo-fi-ing it a little more, you know, but that just makes it vibey, you know. Shit's real vibey. So that's why I made this kind of beat, and that's the kind of flow that I would expect people to flow on that kind of track. Back in the day when I was making beats, I did not want to make these kind of beats because everybody in my part of town in Houston was doing that shit. But nowadays, I'm gonna talk some shit a little bit. Nowadays, what they're doing nowadays is fucked up, dude. Everybody's chasing, they're not even doing like Houston shit. Like, I heard dudes in Houston, they're not even doing Houston's sound. But then it's like, well, I'm in Atlanta, I'm not doing Atlanta sound. But then what is Atlanta sound, right? Like, I don't want to make a video about just ranting here, but what's Atlanta sound, right? Atlanta sound was just trap. Well, let's go back to the time when these kind of beats were being made in Houston, right? Well, what was being done in Atlanta? They weren't doing trap music, right? They were doing, like, it was Outkast, and it was the Dungeon Family, right? And it was Goody Mob. And now, let's be honest, that's a like a conscious, you know, East Coast type of sound that they were doing. With southern elements to it, you know, with organized noise productions and stuff. And their sound was great, man. And to me, that's the Roots Atlanta sound. Because trap really is kind of a play off of what they were doing in Memphis. Let's be honest. It's that Memphis lo-fi first and foremost. That's where most of this comes from. And then it's mixed in with a little bit of what they were doing in Louisiana, right? So a little bit of that New Orleans sound. A little bit of that Manny Fresh. A little bit of that, but more so than Manny Fresh, probably the No Limit production style. What they were doing. Beats by the Pound. It's a little bit like that Beats by the Pound vibe with that DJ Paul vibe. And then they worked on it from there to make trap music, you know? Because you talk about like, let's talk about like T.I.'s album when he called it trap music, you know? Like, those beats on there, they don't sound like today's trap music, obviously. They don't sound like drill or nothing like that. That's all, in a way, that's kind of evolved from there, you know? But that was their sound, you know? Like, if you listen to T.I.'s first shit, actually, you even listen to shit from Young Jeezy, right? Like, Jeezy's, he had that one song, like, I can't remember how it goes. And then what? You know, like that song. Well, anyway, Manny Fresh produced that, right? So that was a New Orleans sound. And then Atlanta just kind of, over time, just became, oh, this is Atlanta sound now. And it's like, that was, you know, in a way, Manny Fresh, like, had a lot of say in Atlanta sound, you know? And so did DJ Paul. And people don't want to admit that, you know, like they are the ones that created that sound. And that's not even an Atlanta sound, a homegrown Atlanta sound, you know. The homegrown Atlanta sound was organized noise and what they were doing, which was mixing like jazz, funk and hip hop, you know, like boom bap hip hop together and putting Southern elements into it, you know. And that was fire too. Like they didn't, and they used the 808s, like the shit that was really popular in Miami. That's another thing too. They did take a little bit from the Miami bass scene from the 90s, but it was, they really just took their drum kits. Like that's really what it was. The drum work, you know, and the 808s and stuff. So they put all that together to make trap music. Trap music is a fusion of all that shit. And, that's not really the Atlanta sound, guys. I'm just telling you. Another one, too, like you talk about Drummer Boy. Remember when he was out here? He's probably still out here. I don't know. But he was producing a lot of stuff on T.I. and Jeezy's albums and stuff. Well, Drummer Boy is from Memphis. So once again, that just plays into what I'm saying. That sound that you people are associating with ATL is really a Memphis and New Orleans sound. And you could say that Atlanta stole the sound, you know. I don't know. I'm not saying, but I'm just saying, like, we just ran with it, right? We just ran with it. Like, all the artists and stuff, they wanted that Memphis, that New Orleans sound, and on their records, because that was the hot sound in the South, and then just became an Atlanta thing. But that wasn't Atlanta sound. Atlanta sound was organized noise. It was Jermaine Dupri. It was, you know, that's ATL. That's the raw ATL sound, you know. The thing about Ludacris's first album, you know, like it wasn't like, you know what I'm saying? It was like that. It was like that too. It was that organized noise type of production style. A lot of it. I think Luda also had Timbaland and he had Pharrell too, you know, producing stuff for him too. But. Really, that Atlanta sound. Oh, God, remember these dudes? Young Bloods, remember those dudes? Shit, there you go. If you were trying to look for what's the classic Atlanta sound, man, that's that. I forgot how that sound, you know, I know that little riff. You know, some of the guitar, you know? God, I'm just ranting. I've been done with this beat for a hot minute, and I'm just over here ranting. But I don't know. I don't get to rant about like production styles and the history of hip hop and stuff like that in this area. So that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, Atlanta's roots are more even somewhat based in what I'm doing right here, too. You know, not screwing things down and stuff, but just, you know, just kind of going more with a boomier, you know, the boom bap drums and stuff, you know, and trying to throw a southern element into it. And in this case, it was the sample, and it was, you know, pitching the sample down and doing all this other stuff. So that's what I'm saying. But anyway, I don't want to talk all night, guys. You guys be good. It's your boy Vigilante Styles. Watch my other videos. Like, subscribe, hit the notification bell. And I'm out. Peace.